Welcome to the first and probably the last Memorial Day videothon. Usually Memorial Day has got a telethon, but we're staying away from the telly, and we're here on YouTube watching this videothon. The purpose of all teaching, spiritual teaching, is it has to be given with a level of clarity that enables the remedy to be seen. Now, most people will find that difficult, but the solution to it is one has to start out spending a little bit of time each day, and then gradually increase that time. So then, someone says, "Well, this is very, very difficult. I'm not used to this teaching." It's not difficult, but we're not used to it. So we say, "I can't do it. It's too tough." Well, the answer is to do it for 1 minute a day, or 5 minutes. Start out with 5 minutes a day, and then gradually increase to 10 minutes, to 15 minutes, and always be trying to increase your time and effort. That is the way that actually works. But the way that doesn't work is to have the teaching lower itself down into lower levels of clarity, less clarity, where the remedy can't be seen. And then that just gets nowhere. That gets nowhere. So always, when you think that the teaching's too difficult, say, well, maybe it's too difficult to pay attention to for long periods of time. But then it means I have to shorten the time and give it everything I've got for a shorter time. Like if someone's out of shape, you can't have them run a marathon right away. You've got to have them jog around the block maybe. Start out, with baby steps. And then eventually work up. Increase one's capacity. That's the way it has to be. It's in this world. The problem is that there's too much teaching that has reached down too low levels of clarity, low amounts of clarity. There are no real levels, low amounts, a lack of sufficient clarity, so that the remedy is not obvious. And that causes more problems than we can even talk about. Because it gets easily then twisted into the ego's agenda. It's easy. Because the context is egoic. So real teaching to be effective has to have a context of truth. And even though that may seem difficult, it's the only way. You just simply have to get acclimatized to it. There's no other way. So acclimatization is really the key. Bit by bit by bit by bit. One gets gradually acclimatized by spending more and more and more time. And it always will feel difficult. Climbing a steep mountain is difficult. The spiritual path is difficult as work. We tend to gravitate towards teachers who have woken up spontaneously without any much work. And, Eckhart Tolle is one of those where he went to sleep one night and woke up the next morning and the quote-unquote, the pain body disappeared, gone. Just like that. And we say, wow, that's what I want. I want to be able to go to sleep one night, wake up without any more troubles. So we're always looking for the teacher who simply didn't have to work at it, just came naturally, easily, spontaneously. We say, that's what I want. I want that to happen. I don't want to have to work at it. Well, guess what? You have to work at it. There aren't any real exceptions. Don't think you're an exception to that rule. Absolutely not. If you think you're an exception to that rule, you'll waste your life. You literally have to get up each morning. And you have to work at it. I've already worked at it this morning for several hours. Woke up in the morning feeling terrible, as usual. The mind is, just spinning out this nonstop, seamless parade of thoughts, of imagery. Last night I was lying there waiting to go to sleep, and the mind was absolutely putting on this incredible show of imagery, like a motion, like a movie. But it was a seamless movie of phantasmagoria of people and situations, everything just morphing into smooth transitions, seamless transitions. Everything just kept arising. All these scenes and all these situations that I've never even seen before. I mean, incredibly creative stuff as far as inventing, imagining situations, etc. And the mind was just putting out, you know, constant, seamless. There was no break to it whatsoever. There was no editing. There was no, like, crossfades. Even better than any movies we can make, because movies that we make have all sorts of editing, fades, cuts, transitions of all sorts, but this was seamless. So the mind is putting on this display of imagination for me, and I'm just watching it. And then in the morning, I could see it's still there, and I see that the mind doesn't stop. This is continuously churning out an inner movie for us. Now, why is the mind doing that? You see, so as I woke up in the morning, I'm looking at that. And gradually I'm able to pull back from all sorts of tensions and hopelessness and such things and get back to the root of the situation and turn it around. So now the momentum is on the side of truth, whereas it seems like when one goes to sleep, the momentum switches over to a delusion, severe delusion. So already today, you know, great efforts have been made. And that's, you know, that's, it's work. Show me someone who has a work ethic. I'll show you someone that will eventually free themselves from delusion, get freed from the horrible situation that we have, that we are bedeviled with. It's the work ethic. And there are those who simply hope that someday they'll get lucky. Don't rely on luck when it comes to something that important. Don't rely on luck. Rely on your work ethic. Okay? I'm telling you for sure. Rely on your work ethic. That is the best teaching. When you think about what is the best teaching, immediately go right to work ethic. The fact that I put in 4 hours today, that's the best teaching. That transcends all teaching because it's the only way you'll really get it. As I look at the world, I don't know. I don't see much work ethic. Superficially in the world, I see none. I'm sure that there are those who do have some sort of work ethic, but it has to be. It has to keep digging deeper. There's no shortcuts to it. It's like digging a ditch. I don't know how many have actually dug ditches. I certainly have. It's hard work. You have to keep digging deeper. You have to keep spending more time. So it doesn't become easier. It's still tough work. There's no way around that. So when the going gets tough, the tough get going. And we're in tough times right now, as we're speaking here on this 28th day of May. We are headed into, as we see, the world is certainly fragile. It's vulnerable to unexpected events. It really is. And don't bank on skating through this situation in the world, that no unexpected events will take place. It seems like they do take place. And it's very important to have a work ethic in place. Very important. Because when the fragility, when things start breaking up, falling apart, then one will turn to one's work ethic and say, I can spend, you know, 4 hours today, clarifying and digging deeper and abiding in satsang. I can spend that time because I'm capable of it. And those who have no work ethic, what are they going to do? That is the question, isn't it? What are they going to do? Because they're relying on the world not breaking up, things not breaking up, and things remaining pretty much the same. Those who have the work ethic, they'll just automatically, they'll say, okay, really time to even get into it more right now. Got the strength. It's like if one's been practicing for a marathon and suddenly one needs to escape from some situation and run a long ways, then one will simply say, okay, I can do it. Start running. Start outrunning the situation because they got legs under them. Because they've been practicing. That's the whole point. The whole point of my posting over the last year here is to encourage everyone to get their legs under them so they can start running. When the time comes to run, they will say, yeah, I can do it. It's not a problem. One should never bank on this world. One should never bank on laziness. One should never bank on inattention. And yet I see the world doing just that. Banking on frivolous entertainment, frivolous diversion. Did you know the Titanic sank in 1912? It was April something, what was it, April 11th or something? 1912. 100 years ago. The Titanic was actually a symbol, an echo from the future. Which is why it's remained in our consciousness, collective consciousness, so strongly. Everyone has this feeling like, you know, that's speaking to us somehow. It's an event that was somehow a precursor event, a warning event about the future. Well, we've now at the 100-year anniversary of that event, where what seemed to be unsinkable, the Titanic was advertised as being unsinkable. Safest ship in the world. Greatest ship ever built. There were a lot of extremely wealthy people on that ship as it sailed, I guess, from England. That area, Great Britain. And the captain was the most experienced captain. And he was, what was he doing? He was speeding full speed through the night, through a very dark night. Through a field of icebergs. Reckless arrogance. Have any parallels with today? The world is going full steam ahead. And yet we have this minefield of financial instability throughout the world. We're going through a minefield and we're still very, very arrogant. We say we have the know-how, we have the capacity, we have the technology. We cannot sink. We're invulnerable. We can just keep on pushing right through. So, the Titanic, I believe, was a warning. And that warning is likely to turn out to be valid. So, obviously, the captain wasn't expecting to hit an iceberg, thinking that, well, the iceberg shouldn't be down this far. But unusual cosmic circumstances were likely contributed to lifting the icebergs off of the shelves, the land shelves where they had been grounded. Many icebergs get grounded on low tide land shelves, And what might have happened was there was some extremely high tide. Various cosmic factors conspired to have an extraordinarily high tide, which, and other factors may have conspired also to lift many, many icebergs off of the shelves where they were sitting and cause them to drift into this, into the path of the Titanic. So unaccounted events, events that are unexpected, can come into the picture, and the prideful, arrogant attitude of push ahead with progress as fast as possible, we're invulnerable, ends up running into those unintended situations, unexpected situations, and they have unintended consequences. So you cannot bank on the world. You cannot sit around simply in frivolous, paying attention to frivolous entertainment, frivolous programs, yucking it up. That's like fattening cattle up for the slaughter. All the programming in the world right now is saying, hey, why pay attention to satsang? That's tough work. Why not just look at these glamorous actors and actresses and funny programs and interesting stuff and crazy, violent, whimsical stuff and just be entertained. Just sit back. We'll entertain you. Just put your eyeballs here on the screen and we'll entertain you. We'll just feed you like you're a baby. Passive feeding like that doesn't engage your capacity for having open ears and digging deeper into truth and clarity. It doesn't engage your clarification, your capacity to clarify. You definitely have the capacity to clarify. Everyone does. It's within us. It's placed there by the Prime Creator. The voice of reason is there. The capacity to clarify is there. Has to be exercised. It's as if somebody never walked. They just sat in a chair and never walked. And then they, when it's time to walk, they say, I can't walk. What do you mean you can walk? I say, no, you got legs. You can walk. They say, well, I've never used them. So you have to use your capacity to clarify. Otherwise, you're banking on the world. That's a bad bet. It's always a bad bet. Maybe some seem to get away with it. They seem to that way. The greatest generation, the World War II generation, they seem to have it really, really good. The GI Bill, you know, enabled them to buy houses, go to college, get degrees, and they just really seem to have a very successful life. They ended up, a lot of them, very wealthy, and country club lives, and vacationing, traveling, and good retirement, good medical, everything. But the fact is that their lives got extremely disrupted when they were young, went through horrible, horrible hell of war, terrible, left lasting scars. So it was no bed of roses there. I don't think any generation escapes unscathed. And it's especially dangerous now to bank on the world, given the fragility of the situation. We're traveling through a minefield, and hoping we get lucky. That's really the situation. We're not going with care. We're not pulling back and saying, whoa, wait a minute. This isn't looking good. You know, the future looks very problematical. Let us assess our options. Nobody's doing that except us here and a few other places. Satsang does that. It says, whoa, wait a minute. Put the brakes on here for a minute. Let us re-examine the situation. Now, how is it that we're able to have this satsang here? Because I spent my entire life doing just that, reassessing the situation. I didn't go forward. I came in the world and I said, well, wait a minute, folks. We need to put the brakes on right now because I guarantee you that eventually you're going to run into a minefield and the fragility is going to end up fragmenting and collapsing. Because I was aware of the future, so I didn't go forward. I put the brakes on. I put the brakes on myself. I said, I am not going to participate in this arrogant progress of the world. So I spent my time clarifying constantly since starting in 1956, nonstop since then, not progressing with along with the world, instead holding back and not going fast, going, you know, very, very slow with the brakes full on. So now we arrive at this point, I'm able to very easily clarify at the deepest levels of clarity, because I'm not committed to the future here. I'm not committed to full speed ahead. So it's easy for me to do this. Now, it's not so easy for those who have attachments to the future here, attachments to rapid progress, to getting somewhere. It's difficult. It's not easy just to, you know, disengage from that. But if one has a lifetime of disengagement, which is what I've had, then obviously it's going to be a lot easier. Because the events of these times have been easily foreseen. If one has perfect clarity, it's possible to see foresee things perfectly as well. The consequences of folly are foreseeable. The consequences of arrogance are foreseeable. Arrogance simply, well, we know what it is. One has to be humble and realize that human progress is not what we claim it to be. And that's what brings us then to the heart of satsang, is clarifying what the situation that we're in really is. What is it really? What's really going on here? And again, the teaching has to hold sufficient clarity so that the remedy can be seen. It's like taking a cable gondola up the side of a mountain, up to the mountaintop, and then you can see. From there, you can see all the landscape. And maybe you can only stay there for a minute, and then you have to take the gondola back down because the air is too rare up there. But the next day, take the gondola back up and stay there for 2 minutes. And keep taking that gondola up the mountainside every single day. That's the way to do it. You cannot do it by climbing up the mountain little bit each day. One has to go all the way to the top each day and just increase the amount of time that one can stay there. That is really the secret to it all. So that's why this teaching continues to talk about the real underlying truth of the situation we're in, which is that we are spirit and we chose an idea that we wanted to be prime creator. We wanted to experience being prime creator. But we're not prime creator. The prime creator created us as spirit. We are the prime created. That is the truth of the situation. When we chose this idea of wanting to experience being prime creator, that's what caused all the problems that we're in right now. And I've clarified those in every video I make. I clarify this whole situation. Right now, we're going to give an additional clarification on this Memorial Day. It's been spoken of before, but we can get even more clarity on it. From a practical standpoint, the trouble that we have here is if we want to be prime creator, we have to forget what we are. We have to forget reality. We have to forget the prime creator, because now we are prime creator. We can't remember, we can't know the prime creator, be experiencing the prime creator, and still believe that we are prime creator. Can't have it both ways. So we have to try and forget. So we have to go into a state of deep forgetfulness, which we have done. And we are pretending to be prime creators, or pretending that we are in the process of becoming prime creators. It's a pretense. We're pretending. And the only problem we have, we think, is that we don't have peace of mind. That we're troubled. We say, yeah, we're prime creators, but something doesn't quite feel right. We're troubled by something. So if we just get rid of this trouble, then we'll not only be prime creator, but we'll feel wonderful as well. Now the ego is our guide to being prime, trying to be prime creator. The ego gives us the guidance, tells us how we can do this. And we listen to the ego as if it were God. We follow the ego's guidance. The ego is just really mind presenting this idea to spirit. Spirit chooses an idea, mind presents it. Spirit chose the idea of wanting to experience being prime creator. Mind says, okay, here it is. Except there's one little problem. Basically, mind says, here it is, but what all mind gives us is a pretense. Just to pretend, we're pretending to be prime creator. But we have to forget what we really are. We have to try and forget what we really are. And that's the little problem. It's the unsolvable problem. Because we still are spirit. We still are the prime created. The prime creator. We're still in the mind of the prime creator. Everything in reality is still exactly the same as it always been. And we are profoundly attracted to that. And there's no way to get rid of that. And that is what troubles us. Because we feel that something is fighting against, is trying to deny us from being prime creator. It's trying to interfere with it. Something is holding us back, we feel. We don't feel settled or stable as prime creators in our pretension. Now, the ego is aware of this, that we have this profound attraction to something else. And from the ego standpoint, that something else is annihilation. Because the ego thinks, well, if we stop pretending to be prime creator, we'll be nothing. Of course, that's not true. So the ego knows there's we have an attraction to something. And so it has to try and wall us off from that attraction. It has to try to obliterate it. Let's say, analogy, we're in a cave. In a very dark cave. And within that dark cave, we're pretending that we are the source of all light. We're the source. We're pretending to be something grandiose within this cave. And we say, we love this cave. But we keep having these memories of light. Keep having these memories of light. And it keeps deep within us. We're attracted to something. And we're not comfortable in the cave. We say, I think if we leave the cave, we'll find something better. There's that feeling. And the ego realizes that we kind of want to leave the cave. We feel there's something better than the cave. And so the ego tells us, you know what? What you need to do is thicken the walls of the cave. Work really hard on thickening the walls. And so here we are every day, building the walls thicker and thicker and thicker and thicker and thicker of the cave, walling ourselves in deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. And the ego tells us that that's the only way to peace of mind that we want, is to make the walls thicker. Because the ego thinks that if the walls are thick enough, we'll give up any thought of trying to escape from the cave, and then we'll have peace of mind. We won't be attracted anymore to trying to escape the cave. That's literally the strategy that the ego is using, is to thicken the walls. That's okay. There's a second flip side to that strategy. The ego's trying to make the inside of the cave more and more attractive. Okay, so there's two things going on, two basic things. Thicken the walls and make the inside of the cave more and more attractive. Put on a show. Make show. Put on these galas, these extravaganzas, these wonderful song and dances inside the cave. And the ego says, look at the great, you know, song and dance that's going on here. The dog and pony show, the circuses, the bread and circuses. Just look at this wonderful entertainment they have here in the cave. And look at all this wonderful food. Wine and song. Wine, women, and song. That's the ego's model. Or sex, drugs, and rock and roll was the 60s thing. Basically, it's saying, look at the luxurious, sensuous, entertaining show that's going on in this cave. It will satisfy all your longings and desires. So, the ego tries to make the what's taking place in the cave more and more attractive, beautify everything. Look at the, look how gorgeous the homes are, the yards are, the streets, the cities, the forests, the state parks, the world, every, and you have access to all this beauty. You can take off for Hawaii anytime you want and luxuriate in the sands of Waikiki. And, you know, go into the rainforests of Costa Rica and trek in Tibet and go anywhere you want to. Just, you know, dig the world, dig into the world. The world's your oyster. The eagle's frantically burning up all the fossil fuels of the planet, trying to present a more attractive cave. The fossil fuels are being used for the green revolution, of course, of fertilizing, applying fossil fuel-based fertilizers on all the crops of the world. So we have these bumper crops, these incredible yields. We're able to support more and more people, and we're able to have more and more plastics, more and more things, more and more gadgets, more vacations, more access to everything, all based on burning up fossil fuels at an incredible rate. We've already reached the peak production, and it's probably declining at this point. So the ego is going all in, trying to make this cave attractive. Wants it to be one big Mardi Gras every day. You know, every day is just an indulgence in the sensuality of the world. Let's make everything so, let's have art sculptures everywhere. Let's have art everywhere. Let's have music everywhere. Let's have wonderful food everywhere. And the food is constantly evolving into more and more sophistication. Let's be able to wine and dine to our heart's content. That's the ego. When we come into the world, the ego seizes upon us and says, "Ah, I'm glad you're here. Now get to work. I have something really important for you to do. Very important mission. You need to try and beautify the world, make it a very attractive place. Do your thing here. Do your part. Do your part to make the cave attractive." Okay, there's that part. And then there's also another part where the ego's saying, make the defenses, make the walls of the cave thicker. Make your defense against being attracted back to reality. Make those defenses stronger. And that involves a lot of false teachings. Twist teachings around and make it seem like God is telling us this is our home, that our duty is to make the cave more attractive. That's what the ego says. The ego claims that God is demanding that we, as our purpose, that we were created for the purpose of making this a cave more attractive. That's what the ego says. That's what the ego tells us. A lot of religion, a lot of beliefs in this world is simply the ego telling us what to think, what to do. Not all of it. Not all of it. It's been distorted. There's a mishmash. It's the problem. But this again is why I say the teaching has to have sufficient clarity that you can see the remedy so that it doesn't get distorted. If you can't see the remedy, then you're at the mercy of distortion. So, for example, when we come into the world, and the ego will see what our talents are. The ego knows what our talents are, the personality, and say, okay, you need to use these talents to make the cave more attractive, and you need these talents to make the walls of the cave thicker. Because in doing so, you will help bring peace of mind to everyone here. And everyone can then pretend to be prime creator without any uneasiness. In order to accomplish that, we would literally have to completely separate from reality, which is impossible. Everything in the mind of God is held there eternally. There is no issue of separation because literally it's an extension of the mind of God. It's seamless extension. There's no way to fragment it. Either all of reality vanishes forever or none of it does. Because you cannot fragment it. You can't knock a chip off of it. You know, here we can fragment everything, which gives us a completely delusional notion of reality. We can, there's every even diamonds, we can cut, you know, facets of diamonds that can be fragmented. Everything here can be cut. Reality cannot be cut, cannot be fragmented at all. It's one seamless whole. It's all one. So, if we were to get rid of it, we have to get rid of it, all of it, which includes us, spirit, too. So we wouldn't even be able to pretend that we're prime creators. Fortunately, we can't do that. We can't get rid of any of it. We can't get rid of it. So it's still there. Reality is still the one seamless one whole of oneness is still there. And we are still completely attracted to it, have this incredible attraction to what we are. And that is always there within us. So no matter how thick we build the walls, we can never build them thick enough. No matter how entertaining we make the world, the cave, the world, we can never make it entertaining enough. But wake up in the morning with a hangover and indigestion and feeling tired and our ears are ringing from the night's entertainment before, and we feel this like, oh God, I feel terrible, you know, and there must be something better. I just feel like there's I feel an attraction to be really truly happy. This is just not doing it for me. See, the attraction is still there. Then we get up, and then the cheerleaders do their song and dance. Go, 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 go team, go. You know, make the world a better place, make it more attractive, make the walls thicker, and you go at it again for another day. And still you feel this lack of fulfillment. You still feel that you're attracted to something else. That something else is reality. You want to remember reality. So that can never be expunged, extinguished. And yet the world is hell-bent on still trying to do that. Which is why that's the captain driving the Titanic through the iceberg field. The ice field, full speed ahead. That's what we're doing, full speed ahead. Let's make more entertainment. The way I combated this was I just found one entertainer that I really liked, and just that's all I listened to. Paid no attention to any of the rest of it. Still had some entertainment, but I had vastly narrowed the field down. It's very helpful. Same thing with the book. I found one book, A Course in Miracles. I didn't need any other books, never didn't need to read any more. Before that, I was reading incredible amount. And after that, I haven't read anything. Don't need to. If you have something really good, then you just say, I don't need the rest. Then that simplifies things, tends to simplify things, but it's not the actual remedy. But one doesn't spend any time chasing around in the search, so it has some expediency to it. Most people are constantly seeking for something new, something better, but if you realize that's a futile path, you deep down you intuitively know this is actually just an attempt to delay my remembrance of what I am. But you're still not able to just drop it all. What I did is just find one act that entertains, and just stick with that. Because then you save a lot of time, because you're not searching, constantly searching. Before, many of us, and myself included, was constantly searching. I gotta find the best music. I gotta keep listening to the radio. Gotta keep, you know, searching, talking to my friends. I was in a quest to find the best music. Had to find the best music. Had to try and compose the best music. And it took up all my time. It was a terrible drain. I gotta go to the concerts. Gotta find the ultimate musical experience. Gotta find what's the best entertainment. And it absorbs, my life was absorbed in that. Then I finally found something that I said, you know what, I could be happy just listening to this for a long time, so I'm going to just stick with this. And I stopped, you know, searching for anything else. And by doing that, it freed up enormous amount of time and effort. And then I put all that freed up time and effort into clarification. Same thing with a book. I used to read, I was constantly looking for the best book. The wisest teachings in a book. And I thought I could find it in a book. And I would read just nonstop. I was a bookworm from early on. And would read thousands and thousands and thousands of books. Sometimes four and five books in one day. I could just plow through books, and I'd finish one and then just start another and just plow through it, 30 pages, an hour, and just so that's like 6 hours, maybe finish a book 6 hours, a little, maybe a little less. And sometimes I'd read 18 hours a day, so I'd get maybe 3 books, maybe 4 books, and depending on what the book is, sometimes I could get through 5 books in a day. And I'd do that for years on end. Really, I spent so much time, and then also I'd be listening to music too, trying to find the best song. I'd listen to so much music, incredible amount. Wasting time this way. Then after I read A Course in Miracles and studied that, I just said, you know what? This book is sufficient for me. Let me just spend time on this one. So I was able to then cut down on the other reading, and eventually it ceased altogether. And eventually I even dropped reading The Course in Miracles because it had produced enough momentum towards clarification. I didn't even need to read it anymore. And so I haven't read any books since. That freed up, a massive amount of time and focus. And I didn't need to. I found a musical expression in the singer George Jones, country music, very, very beautifully produced country music that was superb. And I said, you know what? I'm happy with this. Let me just stick with this. And I dropped all their music. Didn't go searching anymore. If I said, if I want to listen to music, I'll just listen to a George Jones song, and then that's it. I say, it's really great, thank you. And then I go back to clarification. No more seeking for music. So as you start to cut out these areas of your life, you're wasting time. There are ways to do it. And the time you save then can be invested in clarification. So you always have to seek for expedience in your life to save time so that you can do satsang. Now, I thought that maybe I could compose music that would help others just listen to that only, but it didn't work because really I didn't have that type of, my life was not designed for that purpose. Theoretically, I could have done that, but my destiny was not in that direction. So I ended up simply, finding the best music that allowed me to free me up from all their music. Because someone else had already done that. Someone has to be smart. And my purpose here is to deliver the clarifications in this world. Point out how to save time. So here we are, somehow you have the time to watch this, which means you've somehow you've been able to free up some of your time in this world. You've found enough expedience to do it. Most people don't have it. They're still in a desperate search, for a song and dance. Like I said, it's practically very difficult to simply drop all attraction to what's going on in the world, just like that. Generally speaking, there needs to be a transitional time where you cut down and just maybe find one song and dance and say that's enough, and then save yourself the time and invest that in clarification. That's just a practical, obvious way that works, instead of an idealistic, theoretical way that you can just suddenly drop everything. That doesn't work that way. You have to use expedience in this world to save time, to free up time, and then invest that time in clarification. That's the way it goes. And so many people read. They read magazines, they read newspapers, they read this, they read that, they read the news. Always reading, this and that. And basically, I freed myself up from doing that. I can still read an occasional news article or something. It's not a problem. I could even listen to an occasional song. It's not a problem. But the obsession, the search, has been broken there. There's no compulsion, no feeling, I've got to find something better. No. So what happens when we invest time in clarification? We're able to touch upon the key elements of the situation. And by touching on the key elements of the situation, we then can see the remedy. That's how it happened with me. I was just simply invested so much time and effort in clarification that I just naturally, it's kind of like walking along a trail, and you sort of reach a point where you see, you have a vista, and you just naturally, there you are, you're at the vista point, you look out and you see, oh, you see the lay of the land beneath you. You say, okay, this is this, and you see where everything is. Just like that, as you continue to walk along the trail of clarification, it just naturally, you reach a point where you the remedy becomes obvious. You say, oh my gosh, I chose the idea of trying to be prime creator, and I cannot become prime creator. I can't experience it. It's impossible. And so obviously I have to choose a different idea. I have to drop this idea. It just becomes completely obvious. Like 1 + 1 = 2. So no one has to, you know, tell me this or channel this or anything. It just becomes obvious. And I'm not believing it because someone told me it. I'm believing it because I see it. So you have the capacity to clarify so that you can see the remedy. And once you see the remedy, then no matter what anyone else says, you still don't say, no, I know what the remedy is for sure. Doesn't matter what the world says. Doesn't matter what the ego says. The ego, of course, will reject this. Doesn't matter. The ego is incapable of seeing this, incapable of seeing the remedy. Its remedy is to wall us off from any attraction to reality, to somehow make the wall so thick and impenetrable that we can no longer feel any attraction to reality. That's its goal. And to keep us focused on the attractiveness of this world. That's the ego's goal. And of course we know that's ridiculous, because we cannot get rid of the attraction to reality. We are spirit. So we simply need to choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to experience being prime creator. Therefore, we don't have to experience forgetfulness. We don't have to experience a scenario of constant modification, of constant fragmentation, of constant vulnerability, of constant efforts to wall us off from what we are, constant efforts to make the world attractive. We don't have to be engaged in that, to pay attention to that at all. What we experience is the overlay, the silent, still, non-modified presence. Presence of non-modification, of just isness, stillness, isness, omnipresent, not moving anywhere, not changing in any way. And then that reminds us of reality, of what we are. That's the remedy. And one can get to the point where the clarification can just see that. It's completely obvious. But the ego will never view us that way. The ego will always view us saying, hey, you need to help out the egoic agenda, whatever talents you have. Work in that way. Work to make the cave more attractive. How can you do that? So the ego sees no benefit whatsoever in anything other than trying to fortify the defenses against attraction to truth and make the cave more attractive. Thicken the walls, make the cave more attractive. That's all that it sees as important. That's all important to the ego. And the ego views each one of us in that light, with that purpose in mind. So the ego targets us. When we come into this world, we are targeted to work on the ego's agenda. And if we reject that ego's agenda, then the ego doesn't know what to do with us and just says, well, I just got to give you some real low task until you develop some higher skill at what I want you to do. The ego will have you digging ditches. If it cannot get you to do something more to its liking, The ego wants to develop the personality, wants to develop the personality, so the personality is very skilled. So we think the ego's a friend because the ego's advocating all this progress, all this learning. Become skilled, become a great, you know, interior decorator, that kind of thing. Become a great landscaper, become a great musician, become a great doctor, become a great manufacturer, become a great venture capitalist, become a great inventor, become a great designer. The ego is sponsoring all of that, and it has all these universities and ways to workshops to become a great farmer, become a great miner, refiner, distributor, become great at what you do. That's the ego's motto. Be great at what you do here. The ego tries to help everyone develop their skill set so that they're very skilled at what they do, which is to make this world a more attractive place and to thicken the walls of the cave, thicken the defenses against being attracted to remembering what we are, really are. So many think that the ego is their friend because the ego is sponsoring and supporting all of this. The ego tries to be very supportive of this. But it's also very ruthless because the fact is that we still are attracted to remember what we are. And the ego sees this as a terrible sin that we have. The ego thinks that we're sinners, okay? Because we still have this attraction to what we are. The ego views that in its light, that's what's called original sin from the ego standpoint. That somehow we still have an attachment to something that we're supposed to let go of. The ego thinks it's attachment to annihilation, to nothingness. And it's got to be rooted out of us, and the ego can't root it out of us yet. And so the ego thinks we're all very bad sinners, and in order to atone for the sin, we need to get rid of the attraction. That's the only way. We need to do something great for the ego. Build some great buildings, you know, build a great city, design a great city, design the public works, water, the gas, electricity, all the utilities, build great monuments, transportation systems, bring about abundance here, be fruitful and multiply, have abundance in this world, all of that, that's all the ego's guidance, that's the ego's purpose. It's not God's purpose at all, but the ego believes it's God. It believes that it's your God. It's the God that is here for you to accomplish what you want to accomplish. It believes in what it's doing, but it's only a belief. It was born from spirit wanting to be prime creator, from that desire. From out of that desire comes the God of that desire, the guide, the one who tells you, this is what you must do. This is your mandate. This is what I'm telling you to do. I'm now in the authority. I speak for your desire. That's the ego. It's not God the prime creator. It's the ego. Most teachings in this world are egoic teachings, even though they use the term God. The whole be fruitful and multiply thing, that's the egoic teaching. All that God, the prime creator, the true prime creator, all that the true prime creator, the one without any other, tells us is to say that the prime creator wants us to function fully as we were created to function. That's it. Which is to choose ideas and to experience them. But the idea of experiencing being prime creator, it cannot be experienced. So we're not really experiencing it. So we're not functioning fully the way we are created to function. We're simply pretending to experience it. But that's not what we were created for. We were not created to pretend to experience something. We were created to actually experience. So everything in this world, we think we're experiencing it. We're only pretending to experience it. We're not actually experiencing it. the world, existence cannot be actually experienced. But the overlay of this world can actually be experienced. See, actual experiencing does not have modification of that actual experiencing taking place. There's no modification of the experiencer. There's no modification of reality. There's no modification of the direction of creation. There's no modification of reality taking place whatsoever in the actual experiencing. Here in this world, we're trying to modify, we want our experiencing to be the modification, the changing of reality. That cannot be experienced. The changing of reality cannot be experienced. So we're not experiencing it. We're only imagining, or we're pretending, or make-believing. God did not create spirit to spend eternity in make-believe. So all God says is, remember what you are, spirit. That's my mandate for you, is you really have no choice but to remember what you are, because I'm not going to change my purpose for you. My purpose for spirit is to actually experience all idea, any and all ideas. Complete freedom of choice, but actually experiencing it. We don't have that choice. We cannot choose to spend eternity in make-believe and get rid of the attraction we feel towards actually experiencing it. We can't do that. Theoretically, we can spend eternity in make-believe, but we will always feel an attraction to go back to actual experiencing. So from a practical standpoint, we will not spend all eternity in make-believe, because we can never get rid of that attraction, and that will bug us so much that we will eventually try to get to the root of it, and then we'll discover, aha, we're just pretending to experience this. So from an actual standpoint, we will not spend all eternity in make-believe. From a theoretical standpoint, we're free to do so, but we won't exercise that option, because the desire to remember what we are will always be with us. Never get rid of it. And so the whole game of make-believe will always be very distasteful for us. Always. And one will not spend an eternity in extreme distastefulness like that. No. Spiritual. The draw back to actually experiencing is so strong. It's like a vast tide that we'll inevitably just say, huh, you know, forget this pretense. It's no good. I don't like it. But eternity is a long time. We won't spend all eternity at it, but we've already spent a long time at it. And we can spend a lot more time at it as well. A lot. And the world is certainly doing its very best to extend that time frame. And for those who are fed up with it, it's a very frightening thing to see the way that the world is going right now. It's a very shocking, very alarming thing. I thought the world would go in a different direction. I was hoping. Maybe it was just a vain hope that all the efforts in the past that would lead to fruits of these times, where people would put the brakes on. Say, wait a minute, let's stop focusing on producing more and more entertainment, and let's focus on satsang. It's that simple. I've got to tell you, using my own life as an example, because I can speak from direct experiencing, or directly. I can speak directly, having gone through it. It's not hearsay. I haven't paid attention to a lot of the entertainments that are going on. Like, I've never watched American Idol America's Got Talent, X Factor, Dancing with the Stars. Never watched a reality show. I stopped watching television altogether. The voice of reason told me one day, just said, hey, I was watching something and said, you know what? It's time for you to stop watching television. I said, oh, come on, I know how to weed out the bad stuff. And I got this urgent impression that I might think I can avoid it, but the pull will be too strong and I'll get pulled into it. And I was literally told that I will fail. If I don't stop, I'm going to fail in what my purpose in this world. And that really scared me. And I stopped cold turkey for an entire year. Never watched a second of television. And that broke whatever attraction was still there. And then also, somehow I was warned ahead of time of the frivolity and entertainment that was to come. And so I literally focused on those areas and kind of got enough familiarity with those areas that when all these programs came along, I was already disinterested in them. For instance, I spent quite a bit of time trying to be a vocal teacher and learning, you know, how to be a really very superb vocalist, a vocal teacher, and thinking that I was going to teach people how to sing. This was before American Idol even started, because somehow I was aware that something like this was going to happen. So by the time American Idol and all this singing mania began, I had already gone beyond that and was no longer really interested in it. I was so confident in myself and what I knew and everything that tuning into that kind of thing held no attraction to me. And so I was able to simply have no attraction to any of this stuff. All the singing mania throughout the world that the world has been swept up in, which is, of course, very much egoic activity. But just trying to produce a song and dance, all the dancing shows, the singing shows, the food shows, all that is attracting us to this world, trying to keep our attention on the world, keep our attention off of satsang. Literally that is what has happened. And somehow I was preconditioned to be able to sidestep all of that. Many areas I was preconditioned, and I ended up being able to sidestep the entire thing. So I've been able to sidestep all of this massive outpouring of entertainment, vast song and dance, and literally put all my attention onto clarification and satsang, and I don't feel like I'm missing anything. If I want to hear someone sing, I can sing to myself better than those people on the shows can sing. Occasionally I do it. Occasionally I'll put on like a George Jones song and harmonize with it or something. And to me, it sounds so good that, you know, for me it's sufficient. Now maybe other people might not think it sounds so good. But for me, I feel like, you know what? If I need to hear some great singing, I can hear it right here. I don't need to turn onto this television. I don't need to watch the commercials. And if you notice, like I still watch occasional baseball games, the commercials are so horrific for the movies, you know. I mean, I don't know how anybody can see the trailers for these movies and not think that we have entered an extraordinarily dark time in this planet. I mean, when we grew up, people are watching Andy Griffith, you know, and Leave It to Beaver, and Father Knows Best, and, you know, these shows that are very high decency and high morality and showed kindness and compassion and friendliness and trust and faith and all these things and taught us to stay away from wickedness and all that stuff. That's what we, you know, grew up on. If you look at these trailers for these movies now, you just have to recognize the complete maniac absurdity of it and realize that this is what sells now in the world. And that means there's people that's what they want to tune into. That's what they want to pay attention to. Well, that's the opposite of satsang. That shows you the lengths that the ego will go to. It'll go to any lengths. It will have these dragons and robots destroying worlds and attacking everything and heroes struggling against these monsters and explosions and attacks of every kind of viciousness, just to get us off away from satsang. You literally can judge a world by how much attention is being paid to satsang and how much is not being paid to satsang. Now, satsang comes in different forms. It's not the province of just one religion, one tradition at all. It simply means the time that you're spending in clarification. It can take place anywhere. In a place of worship, in a place of solitude, in a group setting, listening to a teacher, reading a book, contemplating, meditating, using expedience throughout your day, all of that can be your satsang. It doesn't have to be a formal thing. Formal satsang can help. It's like a discipline. It's like having a trainer. A trainer can really help. Some people don't like that. I'm not big on that, but I would certainly welcome it if it came to that. But I've managed to get it in many, many different ways. And for some that's the path. I have to use every expedient possible to continue to stay focused on clarity and to don't allow your attention to get pulled into the ego's works. Hollywood is 100% the ego. The entertainment industry is 100% the ego. Everything it puts out is saying, pay attention to this, pay attention to this, pay attention to this. And it tries to claim that it's at no expense to you. Really? Well, if you spend 2.5 hours, 2 hours on that, that's at the expense of satsang. You could have spent those 2 hours on satsang instead, on clarification instead. And if you're reading all these books about magic, most of the stuff in today is about magic. Very dark stuff. And the time that one spends on that and thinking a daydream, etc., that could be spent on satsang. So it is at your expense. Just a minute here. I may have to pause this or stop it. Hold on. Seems as though someone might be looking for me. I might have to stop, but it's the Memorial Day telethon, so we can always produce another video. But these putting attention on something other than satsang is at the expense of satsang. It is at the expense of you remembering what you are, going in that direction. It is at that expense. You're paying a severe price. So when all these entertainment trailers that say, watch this, watch this, watch this. Hold on again. Just one moment here.
Did he find the gopher? He just sort of shook his head. You haven't found him yet, huh? Oh, well, it's going to be a nice day. Someday, when I... Do we still have that little green cart on wheels that I...
No.
Handy, but I had to stop using it because I couldn't get up out of it.
Oh, yeah.
But I wish there was something like that.
Well,
because
I
had something
like
that.
There, it's back there.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, by the
oh, it was too something.
In the corner there, yeah.
Oh. I might try and see if I can get up out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Because that would be the way to deadhead some of these things that are so low.
Okay.
Okay, let me wrap this one up and I'll produce another one in a little while. Got some interruption there.